There's no doubt that Formula One is the pinnacle of technology, both in terms of engine, chassis and electronics. However, when we're dealing with the older F1 cars now, sometimes getting access to the software and the systems to maintain the engine management can be a little bit tricky. Particularly with some of these heritage cars, we are seeing the need for the electronics package to be updated. Now behind me, we've got an FW19 Williams F1 car. This was raced by Jacques Villeneuve in the 1997 race series. And we're here with Milan from PerSysTec, who has been charged with an electronics upgrade on this particular car. We're going to find out what actually goes into modernizing a 1997 F1 car. So I guess first of all, Milan, 1997, it's a while back, but still in terms of electronics, I'm guessing that the systems in this car were still pretty advanced. What was the sort of impetus for upgrading them?
So I think the main reason to upgrade the system was to be able to maintain it these days, because you know the laptops and the computers from 1997 are no longer supported by Microsoft or any of the PC companies. So that was one of the main goals, as well as being able to have people knowing the system and being able to support it. So
can we go back and talk about what was the ECU, engine control unit, fitted to the car back in 97?
So back in 97, it was Magneti Marelli system. I believe it was a compulsory system for every team in the championship. And so what sort of the thing we did is that we replaced it with modern Cosworth electronic system that is sustainable, running the highest motorsport events in the world, LMP1, LMP2.
When you're looking at doing an upgrade for the electronics on a car that is so valuable with so much heritage behind it, what sort of considerations do you need to keep in mind? Is it possible to revert to the original Magneti Marelli if you wanted to for any reason, or is this a whole new wiring harness to suit the Cosworth?
It is actually the whole new wiring. It's not possible easily to revert back to Magneti Marelli, as well as the parts aren't available anymore. So, you know, from the perspective of the spare parts, it's really easy to go and buy a new Cosworth electronics book, but it's not possible to buy an old Magneti Marelli.
Now, in terms of integrating that engine control unit with the rest of the chassis electronics, I understand there is still a Williams control unit there that's in charge of some of the other parts on the car. Can you talk to us about that and what it does?
So the entire chassis system is controlled by a VCM, which is a vehicle control management system designed and built by Williams. So Williams is still able to supply and maintain the functionality of that box. They're getting short on the parts of such an old box, but they still have the people working at the factory being able to calibrate and set up all the hydraulics things, because that's the most advanced parts in the car. You know, the gearbox is hydraulic, the clutch is hydraulic, differential's hydraulic, so that's the most difficult bit of it.
Okay, so just to clarify, that VCM unit there is controlling aspects such as the clutch engagement. Now, unlike a normal road car, that's controlled by a paddle on the back of the steering wheel. And you've also got, in this case, the gearbox is mainly a conventional dog engagement sequential gearbox, but hydraulically actuated. Now, I'm guessing, though, there's going to be some interaction between the brand new Cosworth electronics and their older Williams VCM. So how does that work? Can you talk us through that?
Yeah, this is actually, that was a bit surprising to me, not on this 1997 car, but the first one we sort of plug and played with Cosworth electronics system was 1992, the FW14B. And the communication is established by CAN 2.0B, which is, you know, still used in the modern cars. So that was, you know, a bit surprising for me, to be honest.
That's fairly early on, I would think, for CAN to be using being used in the motorsport industry. But again, I guess that's where F1 really is different. It is that pinnacle of motorsport. So these days, for both factory engine management systems as well as our aftermarket ECUs, CAN is a fairly common protocol, two-way communication bus where messages can be sent between different electronic modules. So how exactly, once you've sort of integrated with that CAN bus, how exactly are you utilizing those messages between the VCM and the Cosworth ECU?
So starting at the 1992, it was more of a basic communication, just, you know, throttle, RPM, and then just information about shifting being triggered. Going more modern cars to 1997, as this one FW19 is, There is more information sent over for the logger mainly, because the VCM is also a complete chassis logger for the team. So there is multiplex messages and messages sent on 1 kHz with all the information from the engine to the chassis system, as well as the chassis system tells more about the rev limiter for the gear shift, about the clutch position, about the torque being delivered.
Just let's talk about one aspect of that you've just mentioned there, that shift strategy. So integrating the Cosworth ECU with that VCM. So let's say, for example, in this case, the driver uses the upshift paddle on the back of the steering wheel. Can you talk us through the process that the shift goes through?
So as soon as the driver hits the pedal, the VCM processes the information, calculates the target RPM after the shift, knowing the gear ratio, and basically sends an information to the ECU to reduce the RPM. That's all then handled in the ECU, how the RPM is reduced. But it's not a conventional cut as you could see on other aftermarket ECUs. It's all controlled by torque and rev limit kind of thing.
So a little bit more advanced than just requesting an ignition cut, for example.
For example, yes.
And drive-by-wire throttle body on this particular car as well?
Yes, there is drive-by-wire. It was originally hydraulic with all the system. It's not so easy these days to store hydraulic controllers, so we replaced the hydraulic actuator with an electric motor that's fast enough to control the throttles on this car.
And we just talk about that a little bit. So, I mean, this car obviously already has a hydraulic system on board, so you've got the reservoir there with high pressure hydraulic fluid, so you're using that already for the gear shift and for the clutch. So interesting, like in the motorsport world, we deal with drive-by-wire almost always. We're going to be dealing with electric. So can you talk to us about the advantages, why drive-by-wire was done with hydraulic back in those days?
So I think one of the reasons, as you just said, is that the hydraulic system was already on board for all the rest of the chassis system. But the main advantage on an F1 car is that it's really fast. If you compare the speed of the movement of the fly-by-wire electric motor to the hydraulic stuff, the size of the fly-by-wire would need to be so big to achieve the same sort of speed. So that's, I think, the main thing.
All right, let's get into the engine itself. So there's a lot of different specifications of engine as we saw the years go by with Formula One and rules change. What specific engine is fitted to this 1997 chassis?
So this FW19 is a Renault 10-cylinder V10 engine, which is air spring valves. So that's pretty normal. It was since 1992 with all the V10 engines, which started at 3.5 liter. Then in 94, I believe, the FIA reduced it to 3-liter engines. So it's really high revving engine.
What sort of RPM are you seeing at the peak?
So the peak is 16,000 RPM on this one, which is pretty impressive considering the technology these days. So,
Talking about the pneumatic valve spring technology there, is there anything tricky that you have to do with the Cosworth ECU in order to manage that side of things, or is that just separate to the ECU?
So that's mechanically separate to the ECU. The only thing that we control is the safety. So if we lose the pressure in the springs, we stop the engine because that would be a severe damage to it.
Just talking about the calibration of the engine, sort of, can you tell us for a start what sort of power is it producing?
So the power is above 650 horsepower. It's been calibrated on a dyno as a normal engine would be. The tricky bit is it's a so low inertia, so to break the engine or to catch the engine on a dyno, there is a special procedure to do this. That's to me the main difference to normal road engines, for example.
When you're starting with tuning a very expensive bespoke F1 engine revving at 16,000 RPM producing in excess of 600 horsepower naturally aspirated, it's got to be a fairly daunting task. Are you able to start with a base calibration essentially sucked out of the initial or original Magneti Marelli ECU, or are you literally starting from a blank sheet of paper on the Cosworth?
Yeah, actually, thanks to the Cosworth electronics, we were able to reverse engineer the whole ECU from the Magneti Marelli system. And that was our base calibration for the new start on the dyno.
Now, these days, in terms of the way the car's being used, obviously, it's not being raced in anger. And for exhibition and historic racing, probably, I'm guessing you don't want to be pushing that engine to the limit. So is there anything you do to detune it or basically just make it a little bit more reliable so it lasts a little longer?
So from the experience, the main thing is to reduce the rev limiter. It's just enough to reduce it by 1,500 RPM, and the ignition advance is reduced a little bit. You can't reduce it too much, otherwise you would get a lot of heat into the exhaust. So that's the main thing we do, and then you know you need to get a professional driver to be able to handle this. So.
Look, Milan, it's been great to get some insight. We don't get to get any of the inside details on older F1 cars too often, so I really appreciate the time for the chat today. Thanks.
Yeah, thank you very much.
If you liked that video, make sure you give it a thumbs up. And if you're not already a subscriber, make sure you're subscribed. We release a new video every week. And if you like free stuff, we've got a great deal for you. Click the link in the description to claim your free spot to our next live lesson.